Yamuna Tira Vanachari Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jayo Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jayo Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivara Dhari Jaya Gopi Janna Vallabha Girivara Dhari Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Yashoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana Yamuna Tira Vanachari Yamuna Tira Vanachari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya So kindly chant the verse behind me.
Shri Uddhav Vacha Naivatmano na Dehasya Samstrir Drishtrir Drishayo Anatma Svadrishorisha Kasya Syad Upalabhyate Shri Uddhav Vacha Naivatmano na Dehasya Samstrir Dashtrir Drishayo Anatma Svadrishorisha Kasya Syad Upalabhyate Shri Uddhav Vacha Naivatmano na Dehasya Samstrir Dashtrir Drishayo Anatma Svadrishorisha Kasya Syad Upalabhyate Shri Uddhav Vacha Naivatmano na Dehasya Samstrir Shri Uddhav Vacha Naivatmano na Dehasya Samstrir Drashtrir Drishayo अनात्मस्वदृशोरीशा Word to word meanings. Shri Uddhav Vacha. Shri Uddhav said. Na. There is not. Eva. Indeed. Atmanah. Of the self. Na. Nor. Dehasya. Of the Lord. Sorry, of the body. Samsritihi. Material existence. Dashtur Drishayo, of the seer or the seen, Anatma, of that which is not spirit, Swadrisho, or of him who has innate knowledge, Ishah, O Lord, Kasya, of whom, Syat, maybe upalabhyate, which is experienced. Translation. Shri Uddhav said, my dear Lord, it is not possible for this material existence to be the experience of either the soul, who is the seer, or of the body, which is the seen object. On the other hand, the spirit soul is innately endowed with perfect knowledge, and on the other hand, the material body is not a conscious living entity. To whom then does this experience of material existence pertain? Purport by the disciples of A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Since the living entity is pure spirit soul, innately full of perfect knowledge and bliss, and since the material body is a biochemical machine without knowledge or personal consciousness, who or what is actually experiencing the ignorance and anxiety of this material existence? The conscious experience of material life cannot be denied. And thus Uddhava asks Lord Krishna this question to elicit a more precise understanding of the process by which illusion occurs. Om Ajnanati Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदामयं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं नमो ओम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे नमो महावदन्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नामिने गौरत्विषे नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार शिवा साधि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Lange Tigrim Yat Kripa Tamaham Vande Shri Gurum Dinatarinam. Hare Krishna. So, we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 28, entitled Jnana Yoga. We just chanted the verse number 10. So, before I begin, I would like to seek blessings and prayers of all the assembled Vaishnavas, offline, online, so that I can speak something meaningful. Hare Krishna. So, here, Uddhava, he is asking a very wonderful question, and in the translation it is mentioned, by nature the soul is pure, Satchidananda Vigraha, endowed with knowledge and bliss, and on the other hand the body is not a conscious entity, it is a dull matter. So the question which Uddhava is asking to Krishna is, then who is that person who is this experiencing the material existence, the pains and pleasures of this material existence. When soul is completely pure, so he is not affected by this material existence. And on the other hand, the dull matter, the which is not conscious, it is also not experiencing. Then who is that experience the material existence, the pains and pleasures of this material world? So Krishna also speaks in Bhagavad Gita this kind of knowledge, especially in 3rd chapter 27th verse, prakriti kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvasha ahankara vivudatma kartaham iti manyate. So here in this verse, Krishna is telling that we are not the doers. Everything is being done by the material nature. And the person who thinks that he is the doer, then he is vimudha, a great fool. And later on in Bhagavad Gita, 18th chapter, 14th verse, we see how Krishna reconciles the same subject matter. And he says, it is not that material energy is the only doer. We are also the doer, and Krishna is also the doer. So it is a kind of paradox. In one place he is telling you are not the doer, but another place he is telling that you are also one of the doers. So similarly, in this verse it is mentioned that soul is pure, so it is not affected by the material existence. On the other hand, material nature is dull matter, so it will also not experience. So how to understand? So this is the achintya bheda bheda tattva. The soul also goes through the experiences of this world and also does not go through the experience of this world. So it is achintya bheda bheda tattva. So let us try to understand this particular concept that is mentioned in this verse. So again, we have this body. Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says in 2nd chapter, dehi nosmin yata dehe kaumaram yavanam jara. We are not this body, we are spirit soul. And immediately in the next verse he says, although we are not body, we have a body. So we have to do something about it. So we have to go through the experience of this body. It cannot be avoided. So whatever pains and pleasures that are there, so what is recommended by Krishna in that verse? He says, so now that we have a body, although we know that we are not this body, but we have a body, so tolerate the difficulties that we get through this body, whether gross or subtle level. The soul, when it comes from the spiritual world, as we have discussed, it is in its purest form, purest state. But as soon as it comes down to this material world, it gets affected by the three modes of material nature. Example that we gave is, a raindrop is very pure by nature. But when it falls down on the earth, when it gets mixes with the mud, the soil of this world, it gets contaminated. So similarly, soul, although it is pure, but when it comes to this material world, it gets contaminated by the association of the three modes. And then soul starts identifying itself with the false ego. And that is where the illusion begins in this world of duality. And we land ourselves in the dream world, in this world of material existence. So sometimes when we feel very cold, may not be in Mumbai, but some northern region of India, when we feel very cold, we wrap ourselves with lot of other clothes, maybe blankets, so that we can become comfortable. So similarly, the soul, when it comes to this material world, it wraps itself with false ego. And this false ego, the thickness of this false ego grows day by day with the association of three modes of material nature. In Bhagavatam, many places Prabhupada mentions that in a dream state, he gives the example that when a tiger is chasing us, we become very horrified, we become terrified by the whole experience. And we also perspire actually, we become so anxious, there is so much of tension and we perspire. But as soon as we come out of the dream, we completely become relieved. So it was false. So it was not a true thing that has happened. We become relieved and we actually laugh at it. You know, what happened? So similarly, but one more point is that although it is not fact, it was a dream, but the experience was real because there was sweat on our forehead. And why this all happens? Because we were so immersed and absorbed in the whole dream. That is why we had to go through that miserable experience. So similarly, soul, when it strongly associates itself with false ego, it experiences the pains and pleasures of this world in its conditioned state. So now, what is this dream state and what is wakeful state is also mentioned in many places in Srimad Bhagavatam. So in contaminated consciousness, one sees that I am the enjoyer and everything that is there in this world is meant for my enjoyment. That is the contaminated consciousness. But on the other hand, what is the pure consciousness? Everything that is there in this world is meant for the enjoyment of Krishna. That is the difference between the dream state and the wakeful state of this world. And since we have just celebrated Ram Navami festival few days back, so I would like to give an example from Ramayana of a personality who actually had this kind of consciousness, this kind of mentality, you know, who was living in a dream world in this material existence, and is none other than the great Ravana. So we can see how he was living in a dream world, and he was increasing the duration of his dream, you know, by doing so many sinful activities. And he wanted to lord over the material nature. That is what this verse is speaking, trying to enjoy the material world. So what are the four things that happens when one when the soul identifies itself with false ego? So four kind of mentalities arises in one's heart. So it is proprietorship, controllership, the doer mentality, and the enjoying mentality, and which again results in exploitative and manipulative mentalities in our hearts. So Ravana is a classic example of these four kinds of mentalities he had actually displayed during his lifetime. So we can see from the life of Ravana how he was totally living in this dream world. So when his mother Kaikasha, when she saw that Kubera, who is the son of his co-wife, so he was so opulent and he was so powerful also, and he also had a pushpaka viman which could fly anywhere. So she became very envious of this, and she wanted these kind of opulences for her children also. So then she approaches all her children and tells them, so why don't you perform tapasya and gain more powers than your cousin Kubera also? So that was the motivation. Envy was the motivation. So then Ravana and his brothers and sister, they all perform tapasya for a long time. And we can see how after thousands of years, then Brahmaji comes, offers a benediction to Ravana. So then he asks that, firstly he asks for the immortality, but which cannot be given by Brahmaji. Then later he tells that, I should not be killed by Gandharvas, Kinnaras, different species he mentions. But he does not feel a need to mention the human beings. So he was so confident, yeah, manav, what they can do to me? I am after all a Rakshasa. We are Rakshasa who generally eat in their breakfast, manavas, and their blood, we drink their blood also. So no need to fear them. So he was so actually arrogant in one sense, overconfident. And then he gets the benediction from Ravana. And then after getting the power, generally the tendency is to show off. Khujli hoti hai bolte na. So when he gets the power, then he wants to show to this world that how powerful I am. So first thing which he does after that is he snatches the pushpak viman from Kubera and also the golden Lanka from him, and then he starts living there himself with his family. And then he goes on for a yatra. We cannot say it's an yatra, but he travels in the pushpak viman, showing off to this world how powerful he is, and he tries to exploit the people. And one time when he was traveling in viman, pushpak viman, he happens to see a beautiful lady who was doing tapasya. And she was chanting the names of Lord Vishnu, and while she was doing tapasya, so he becomes very disturbed, annoyed when he hears the name of Lord Vishnu. That is the nature of the asuras; they cannot stand the names of Lord. And then he approaches that lady desiring to enjoy her. So this is the contaminated consciousness of Ravana, we can see. How he thought that everything which is there in this world is meant for my enjoyment. So with that mentality, you know, he was trying to exploit people all over. And then we can see how she was only desiring to have Lord Vishnu as her husband. And immediately she curses him. She curses Ravana that, my dear Ravana, not dear, my Mr. Ravan, you know, soon I will take birth again in future and I will be the cause of destruction of your dynasty as well as you yourself. So that is the curse he gets from Vedavati. And then one time he was traveling again in Pushpak Viman. He happens to come to Ayodhya. So at that time, Araranya was the king of Ayodhya. So unnecessarily, without any reason, he starts fighting with this king. And he thoroughly defeats him and actually kills him. And before dying, this king, he again curses Ravana. That soon I will again, a great personality is going to come in our dynasty who will be the cause of your destruction. So these were the exploits of Ravana. So he was going on accumulating curses. And he was feeling proud of that also. So another time he comes across Rambha, the heavenly damsels, beautiful heavenly damsels. And she also curses. He exploits her. You know, molests her, and then she becomes so angry and she curses that whenever you try to approach any lady trying to enjoy her without her consent, then immediately you will die. So this is the yatra of Ravana, you know, collecting different curses from various personalities. So because of his attachment to sense enjoyment, because he was so illusioned, He forgot what he was doing actually. So that is the power of the material nature. So instead of collecting blessings, he went on collecting curses. And he was such a foolish person in one sense, although he was so powerful, but he was not utilizing his intelligence in a proper thing. And we can see from Mahabharata's story how collecting blessings is so important. So when during the time of exile, Arjuna goes to the Himalayas to collect the divine weapons, and Bhima also goes and, you know, tries to increase his power. And then Krishna, he recommends Draupadi and Yudhishthir to serve the sages in the forest. And by doing that, you will actually collect a lot of blessings from them, and that will increase your power. So this is the power of collecting blessings from our seniors, from elders, from our guru also. So then another exploit we can see from the life of Ravan. He wanted his citizens to go to the heavenly planets without any qualifications. So he made an arrangement of a staircase, direct staircase to Indralok, heavenly planets. Of course, it didn't work. So the idea was that, you know, without any qualifications, he wanted all his citizens to go to heavenly planets. Paap karne ke baad bhi swarga prapti. That was the scheme of Ravana. So anyway, it eventually failed. So we can see from the life of Ravana how he was given counseling by so many of his relatives time and again, but still he did not heed to their advice. So we can see Maricha. So when he approached Maricha to kidnap Sita, so Maricha tells about his previous experience. So one time when Lord Ram, he was in Dandakaranya, he actually killed 14,000 soldiers in 1 hour, including Khar and Dushan. And he shot an arrow at me, because of which I actually fell so many yojanas away, hundreds of yojanas far away. And it was such a blow I can never forget. So whenever I hear the word Ra, I become fearful. So that was kind of experience which Maricha went through. And then later on he renounces, he becomes a sadhu. I don't know what kind of sadhu, but he takes to renunciation after that experience from Lord Ramachandra. So he tells to Ravana, my dear sir, please don't fight with this Ram, he is very powerful, don't kidnap Sita, forget this idea. So at that time Ravana actually accepts the advice of Maricha. He decides that, you know, chalega, I don't want this Sita, I am happy. So then we can see how Vibhishan also, he tried to give counseling several times to Ravana, but still he could not take that. So Mandodari, his wife, she also gave counseling several times. Even during the war time also she said, can't you see your brother is dead, your son is dead, but still you want Sita? Why don't you just give up this idea, give it her back? But still he could not understand. So like we see, after getting the advice of Maricha, he actually gives up this idea of kidnapping Sita, until one day Shurpanaka again comes to the palace of Ravana and she provokes him. She tells him, my dear brother, what are you doing? You are not kidnapping Sita. I will tell you, this Sita is very beautiful. She is meant just for you and no one else. And when he hears this, he could not resist. Now there is two things. Maricha tells to Ravana about the power of Lord Ramchandra, and Sita tells Ravana, Shurpanaka tells Ravana about the beauty of Mother Sita. So because of his lust, which was his very nature, so he could not see the advice given by Maricha. Then again he decides that I should kidnap Sita to enjoy. So then he actually meditates before deciding. He meditates, he contemplates, you know, she is so beautiful, you know, she is meant for me. So this is the whole cycle of how a person gets illusion, as mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. Dhyayato vishayan bhumsam sangaste supajayate. And then finally he prays lust to this, fall prey to this lust. So as I said before, how even after seeing all his commanders dying, the powerful warriors from his side dying in front of him, including Kumbhakarna, and also his son Indrajit, who actually defeated Indra, he also died. But still he could not understand because of ahankar. He could not give up this false ego. It was so thick, so difficult for him to give up this. So we also see Ravana had all the opulences. You might be wondering, today is the discussion of only Ravana. Anyway, we should know the power of Ravana so that we can appreciate the deeds of Lord Ramachandra. That is the whole idea. So we see he had all the opulences that is mentioned by Kunti Devi, Kunti Maharani in Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 1. She says, Janma Ishwarya Shruta Shribhi. So he had all these opulences. Janma, he was born from a father who was from a Brahmana clan. And then Aishwarya, he had so much of opulences, although it was all looted mal from Kuvera and many other places. But still he was rich, whatever it is. Shruta, he was very learned in Shastras. So he was a Shastragya also. Shri, beauty. Some say he was very ugly, but in some places it is mentioned that he was very beautiful, brownish in color. He has a complexion, brownish complexion. And he has a very powerful build. So in that sense, he was beauty also. It was said he had hundreds and hundreds of queens before he decided to kidnap Sita. So all of them, they were attracted to Ravana. So all of them, they were obedient to Ravana. All of them respected Ravana. So, I mean, he had such beauty by which he can actually attract so many queens. So because of these four riches, four opulences that he had, so they all became obstacles for him, because of which he could not able to listen to the good advice given by his well-wishers. So this is all because of the illusion. So he was always dreaming. So he was in a dream state throughout. So our ahankar, it is further bloated when we are surrounded by enemies, you know, in the form of well-wishers. Sometimes they claim that they are our well-wishers, but they are enemies and they bloat our false ego every now and then. So in case of Ravana, we can see, so when one time Ravana was sitting in the on his throne, so he was very morose and disappointed. So all the ministers, they ask him, what is the problem? I think you are disturbed because of this Sita. She is not agreeing to your proposal. Yes, yes, that is right. Then all the ministers, they advise him, why don't you just exploit her? Why don't you just molest her? So then he narrates the whole story of Ramba, how he gets the curse. And without the consent of Sita, I cannot touch her also. I will die immediately. So he was so shameless. So he had to tell his stories. And ministers, they were they were all flatterers actually. So he was having a bad association in one sense, in the form of his ministers. It is said that a king is known by the council of ministers. So the more the powerful the council of ministers, the king will become more powerful. But here we can see all the ministers, they were dull-headed. Their only objective was also to sense enjoyment. Dussanga, bad association. And as a result of that, he landed in more and more problems. So we can also see one of the important instructions that is given to Vaishnavas is Asat Sanga Tyaga, a Vaishnava Achar. So in Nectar of Instruction, it is specified in two different verses. It is repeated actually, how important that particular instruction is, to give up the association of non-devotees, materialistic people. So again, we have these two things, Vishaya and Vishayi. Vishayi is the sense object. So it is said it is more dangerous to associate with a Vishayi than a Vishaya also. Why? Because Vishayi is always thinking about how to increase his sense of enjoyment. And that mentality can also creep in us. It will also get into us. And that is more dangerous. A person may get into some enjoyment with some sense object and he will forget. But Vishayi, the desire will become more and more deep-rooted in our hearts. Very difficult to get rid of it. So it is better. It is not better, both are not good only, but more dangerous is to associate with a Vishayi, even than a Vishaya. So who is the person? Now we have seen who is the person who actually experiences the pains and pleasures of this world. So we have seen the example of Ravana, how he was living in a dream state, in a dream world, influenced by the illusory energy of the Lord. So he was thinking he is all in all. He was thinking, I am the proprietor, I am the controller, I am the enjoyer, I am the doer. And because of this, he was actually going through the experiences which otherwise soul would never go through because of its pure state. So now we see, what is the other side of this? So who is a self-realized soul? In Srimad Bhagavatam 11th canto, 11th chapter, it's mentioned, like sky does not mix with anything, it is unaffected, it doesn't get entangled with any of the objects of this world, and sun is not at all attached to the water in which it is reflected, and wind is also not affected by different kinds of aromas in the atmosphere. Similarly, a self-realized soul is completely detached from material body and the world around it. So he is like a person who has awakened from a dream state. So that is the position of a self-realized soul. He has just come out of the dream state. He knows who he is, what is the relationship with Krishna. So he is called as Jivan Mukta. So while living in this world, a person becomes completely detached from the material conception of life. Iha yasya harir dasya karmana manasagira nikilashvapi avasthasu Jivan Mukta sauchyate. So here we can see how, while living in this world, a person, while he engages himself in the service of Krishna with his body, mind and intelligence, he is on a platform of liberated stage. He doesn't get entangled in the material activities of this world while living in this world. He is living in this world, but he doesn't become of this world. That is the definition of Jivan Mukta. Bhagavad Gita also speaks about this concept of Jivan Mukta. Mam chayo avyabhicharena bhakti yogena sevate sa gunan samatittaitvan brahma bhuyaya kalpate. So brahma bhuyaya kalpate is the same consciousness. A person whose consciousness is situated in transcendence, that is the characteristic of a person who is a Jivan Mukta. So now in second chapter Bhagavad Gita, Krishna also explains about the symptoms of this person, what kind of symptoms this Jivan Mukta has. So we see the last section of second chapter Bhagavad Gita, we see from verses 54 till 71, the symptoms of a Jivan Mukta is discussed. So the general symptoms, it is mentioned that such a person rejects all the external pleasures of this world and he rejoices only in the internal pleasures. So he doesn't get attracted by the external pleasures of this world. So that is the general symptoms of a person who is Jivan Mukta. And then further it is explained, how does he speaks? What is his speech? So it is said that he is not disturbed in the mind amidst threefold miseries, and he doesn't get elated in happiness and morose in misery. So these are the symptoms. And he is also free from any kinds of attachment, fear and anger, whether he may receive good or evil of this world, neither praising nor despising whatever he is receiving. So this is how he speaks in this world. This is his speech. And how does he sits? So it is mentioned, like a turtle, example is given that of turtle, which actually withdraws all its senses whenever it is attacked. So all the limbs of the turtle, they are very vulnerable. So it cannot expose its limbs to the dangers. So it withdraws all its limbs inside. So similarly, a self-realized soul, so whenever necessary, he engages his senses in spiritual activities. But whenever it is not needed, he withdraws them. He doesn't engage his senses in sense gratification. And how does he walk? So when he attains the Lord's mercy, his intelligence is established and he attains a peaceful state of mind. So these are the symptoms that is mentioned in Srimad Bhagavad Gita, second chapter, of a person who is self-realized, who is a Jivan Mukta. So now we will see some examples who has this kind of consciousness, you know, whose consciousness is merged in transcendence, who is a Jivan Mukta, from scriptures and also from our acharyas. So even again from Ramayana we see Hanumanji. What is the highest form of self-realization? It is the state, it is the consciousness wherein a person thinks, I am the eternal servant of Krishna. So always he carries this consciousness in his heart, and he, all his activities are based on this particular consciousness. I am the servant of Krishna. So we can see Hanumanji, he actually had this kind of consciousness. So he was completely situated in this particular consciousness of, I am the servant of Lord Ram. So when he was caught by the soldiers, and he was brought in front of Ravan. So at that time, Ravana asks him, who are you? So without hesitation, without any thinking, what comes out? He says, Dasosmi Koshalendrasya. That was the immediate answer that comes out from his mouth. I am servant of Lord Ramchandra. So that was the consciousness which Hanumanji was carrying all through while he was serving Lord Ram. So even while he was searching for Mother Sita in Lanka, so he had to see, he had to peep in all the inner chambers of Ravana's Mahal, and wherein he had to actually see so many ladies. And it is not befitting for a brahmachari to do this kind of service, but he was there on the order of Lord Ram. So he was constantly chanting the names of Lord Ram, you know. So he was always situated in this consciousness of chanting Lord's names, and the consciousness that I am servant of Lord Ram. So that is one wonderful example we can see from Ramayana itself, a person who actually carried this kind of consciousness of Jivan Mukta. And now we have been discussing how this material world is a dream world, you know, and how we get affected by the three modes of material nature, and how we get affected by the illusory energy of the Lord. So now what is recommended? Don't go on dreaming. Now come out of the dream also. That has been recommended. And our acharyas also, they also say that, why stay in that dream? Wake up and come out of the dream. So we have a beautiful bhajan by Bhakti Vinod Thakur, wherein says, jeev jago, gora chanda bole,
Kotha nidra jao maya pishachira kule.
Wake up, oh sleeping souls. I mean, please do not take it literally. It has a different meaning here. So wake up, sleeping souls. How long will you sleep in the lap of Maya? So it is like, you know, it is not like every day we put an alarm to wake up early in the morning at 4 a.m. and we keep on snoozing whenever we get a wake-up call. No, it is a very serious business which Bhakti Veera Thakur is talking about. So whenever we face problems in life, we get come across calamities in this life. So it is said, His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj says that, so calamities, they are like wake-up calls. And what is our problem? We snooze this also, baad mein. I will attend to this, I will not take seriously now, maybe later on. Abhi to jeevan baki hai. So we postpone our surrender, that is our problem. We keep on snoozing on this particular aspect. And we also have a support from Shastra. Matra sparshastu konteya shitoshna sukha dukkada. The problem which I am facing is also temporary. Chala jayega. Phir achhe din aayenge, you know, I will become happy again. So don't worry, we can surrender later on. So this is the dreamland of illusion in which we are living. So we keep on, even after hearing such strong words from our acharyas, we have a tendency to postpone our surrender, not taking the serious calls, wake up calls seriously. So then again, in the next stanza, Enechi aushadi maya nashibaru lagi harinama maha mantra lao tumi magvi. So Mahaprabhu says, I have brought the medicine that will wipe out the disease of illusion. So we have a solution given by Mahaprabhu. So the medicine is given. Medicine is the holy names of the Lord, which can actually wipe out the disease of illusion. The illusion that, you know, this world is all in all. This is wonderful. So we can come out of this illusion when we take to this medicine. So mostly in this world, we can see that it is all play of the illusory energy. And we get so much affected by it. But many times the Lord also plays, comes to play in this material world by performing His leelas. He descends into this material world, performs His pastimes. As we were discussing the previous day, the beautiful pastimes of Lord Ramachandra. So He also plays His play in this material world, apart from the play of the illusory energy. So we can take benefit of this. And sometimes the Lord sends His empowered devotees. They also come here to, they also do pastimes. They also try to instruct us, inspire us in so many ways, so that we can take this seriously of coming out of the dream world. Now this word dream, we have been discussing about this word dream in a negative sense, but it also has a positivity. We can also use this word positively, for positive aspirations. Like Prabhupada used to say, dream big. So when Prabhupada came to America for the first time, so he was sitting in the park and he was chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra. He was doing kirtan. So then at that time he said, there will be so many temples and devotees that is going to come in future. And of course, Prabhupada dream, it's not an overconfidence. Prabhupada was actually confident. He had confidence in Krishna. So that is Prabhupada's confidence. His confidence was based on confidence in Krishna. So that is how, although he had such big dream, and definitely he worked hard also to fulfill his dreams. So that is the symptoms which Prabhupada was also carrying, the symptoms of Jivan Mukta. So although he was relishing Krishna when he was staying in Vrindavan, he was completely in that state of Jivan Mukta. He was relishing Krishna all the time there. But he went one step further than this particular state of consciousness of reaching out to the fallen souls, to preach out of compassion and to share the burden of Lord Krishna. So that was the consciousness which Prabhupada had. You know, even it is more advanced. So one time, these are during the last days of Srila Prabhupada. So Prabhupada, one time he told his disciples, I want to go to London. So then the doctor said, you are so frail, you are so weak, and you cannot move also. You cannot go, it's not possible. But then Prabhupada insisted, no, I have to go to London, I have to preach. So that was his constant meditation of, you know, preaching to the fallen souls. And he went actually, he went and preached in London like a spiritual warrior. And also we can see at the end of his life, his consciousness was so perfect. Even in that state of so much of pain, he could able to translate the purpose of Srimad Bhagavatam. So that is the kind of consciousness he was having, completely aloof from the pains and pleasures of this world. So he had this consciousness that he was servant of Krishna. He always carried this consciousness in his heart. So one time when Allen Ginsberg, he asked this question to Prabhupada, are you the Jagat Guru of this world? Are you the Jagat Guru? Then Prabhupada humbly replied, I am no one's guru, I am servant of all. I am just an insignificant servant. So Prabhupada just did not speak these words, he actually meant these words. So he was feeling from his heart. And based on this consciousness, he was actually performing all the activities. So his activities were all rooted in this consciousness that I am servant of everyone, I am servant of Krishna. So now, what is for us? So in the verse it is mentioned how a soul, although it is pure, in pure state, you know, he doesn't undergo the experiences of this material existence, and how dull matter being non-conscious, it also does not undergo the experiences of this world. So we have seen how it goes, the soul goes and also does not goes through these experiences of pain and pleasures of this world. And so what is for us to learn from this, the whole episode? So can we also dream? Yes, we can also dream. We can also have very positive spiritual aspirations in our life. We can also dream to serve the Lord. We can also dream, you know, to serve sincerely, to perform our devotional service sincerely. And we can also dream to actually come out of this illusory energy, illusory material existence, which is a dream world. And we can all work to it, not only just dream, but also work towards it in our day-to-day lives. So we can have such kind of dreams. Like I remember long back, I was doing this multi-level marketing. What is that product? Amway products. Although I never was successful in that, I just tried. So they used to say one thing, the power of written words. So they used to say, you know, whatever desires you have, whatever, you know, goals you have in your life, you should write it down and paste it on the walls of your house so that every day you can meditate on it. And subconsciously, you know, this desire gets into your subconscious mind and you start working towards it without your knowledge. You know, that is the power of written words. So they also used to say, you know, we should dream big. So we can also do that. We can also dream of, you know, we can also write on the walls of the places where we actually most visit. We can also write, let me not criticize others. Let me see good in others. Let me become sincere in my morning program. Let me become sincere in my japa. So we can also dream. Maybe a better word would be aspire actually, not dream. So we can have such positive aspirations in our life, which will help us to come out of this illusory material existence. So to summarize what we have discussed, so we saw how this world is a dreamland where in the conditioned state the soul identifies itself with the false ego and therefore it experiences the pains and pleasures of this world. And we also saw a classic example from Ramayana about Ravana, who had this consciousness of, you know, wanting to lord over the material nature, trying to enjoy whatever is there in this world. So his consciousness was everything that is there is meant for my enjoyment. So we saw that example. And then we saw another example of a person who is Jivan Mukta, who had the consciousness that, you know, everything is meant for Krishna's enjoyment. And we saw an example of Hanumanji and our beloved Acharya Srila Prabhupada, how they manifested the symptoms of Jivan Mukta. So then at the end we saw that how we can also dream to sincerely practice our devotional service, and thereby we can perfect our lives. Hare Krishna. Anyone has any comments to add? Yes, Prabhu.
So just like you gave a wonderful class, like how Ravana was collecting curses, you know, and also we should try to collect blessings. So like how we can like do consciously to collect blessings in our life, like
this was actually demonstrated by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself when he was there. So it is not that we have to do big things. Even with small things we can collect blessings. Like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he used to dry the washed clothes of his devotees. It appears to be very simple, but he would take them away from the ropes and then fold them and keep it nicely after the clothes are dried. I feel this is just a simple example of how a person can receive blessings, an easy way to receive blessings of devotees, and constantly encouraging each other and helping each other. Like when I go to Nair College, I also ask them, so what is your goal pursuing this medical studies? So no one knows what is the goal. Bas aage, someone pushed them, so they are there. They don't know what is the purpose. So then I told them, now you let us define the purpose, why we came here. So then after going through the exercise, then they come out with different reasons. They say, we want to help others also by this profession. So then I ask them one question. So whenever you see an old person, trying to cross the road, do you ever help such persons? So many of them raise their hands actually. So these are the small things, where we can collect blessings. The person may not directly tell her, I bless you, but it was noticed by Krishna. That particular act is noticed by Krishna. So we will get blessings from Krishna. So these are the small things by which we can again, and by serving great souls. Shyam Mahat Sevaya Vipra, Srimad Bhagavatam also speaks. And also His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj tells one of the ways in which we can increase our taste in chanting is by serving great souls. Shyam Mahat Sevaya. Vasudeva Katha Ruchi. We can develop taste in Vasudeva Katha by serving great souls. And many times people mistake who is a great soul. So many of them, they have great soul is only Prabhupada or my guru. No, great soul is the devotee who is sitting by our side. He is a great soul to us. So every soul who has come into Krishna consciousness trying to perform bhakti is a great soul for us, and we can serve them in various ways. I just gave few examples, but we can serve in so many ways, encouraging each other, helping each other. Hare Krishna. Any other comment? Or Radhika Valla Prabhu would like to add something? Thank you very much. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki
Jai. Thank you.